Sabır. Not yet.
Oh, it's still 12 minutes.
I can't hear you, and I'm the only one on the call, so you can speak up.
I was going to say, can you mute yourself for now?
Yeah.
All power to the people, Chairman Jake.
All power.
So we got some minutes. So let's give it to 5 minutes after four to get people enough time to get on.
Yeah, I sent the link out. If you got a network, I want to drop it there.
Yeah, all power to the people.
Power.
Chairman Jake, you can't play like some Huey or something until like 5 minutes after four, so that folks just won't just be sitting in the chat.
Yeah, I got you. 1 second.
All right.
Daddy, I think my spider's pregnant. Dad, it's adorable. The spider's using the weed.
Farewell, expensive fitness gear. I can't afford you.
Don't give up the things you love.
Stay calm.
We have the last artist here on the show tonight. Someone I'm sure you've been looking forward to hearing and seeing for the first time in England. He's one of his recordings was recently voted, I'm told. I saw voted the most popular, whatever they call R&B, whatever R&B is, a recording.
What's going out now, friend? Just smokes that night. In the Oh!
Personality. I know you're anger. I know you're crazy. country can do for you.
All right, Shaka, I don't know if you want to start now.
All power to the people, comrades. All power to the people, brothers and sisters. And I know we probably have some enemies on here as well. All power to the people. Last week we left off with George basically describing the kind of life that he had lived since coming to consciousness, revolutionary consciousness. He said, quote, born to a premature death, a menial subsistence wage worker, odd job man, the cleaner, the court, the man under hatches, without bail, that's me, the colonial victim. So I just wanted to emphasize where we left off, brothers and sisters, before we go into the second text. And our comrade is going to put up the book so comrades can follow along who don't have it at their immediate disposal. So brothers and sisters, revolution within a modern industrial capitalist society can only mean the overthrow of all existing property relations and the destruction of all institutions that directly or indirectly support existing property relations. It must include the total suppression of all classes and individuals who endorse the present state of property relations or who stand to gain from it.
Just one question. Which page is it on?
Well, it's still on page six.
Six, okay. Sorry about that. Go ahead.
Let me get that right over so the brothers and sisters can follow us. That's just coming on. Revolution within a modern industrial capitalist society can only mean an overthrow of all existing property relations and the destruction of all institutions that directly or indirectly support existing property relations. It must include the total suppression of all classes and individuals who endorse the present state of property relations or who stand to gain from it. Anything less than this is reform. Government and the infrastructure of the enemy capitalist state must be destroyed to get at the heart of the problem, property relations. Let's talk about that. Let's get back to that. Government and the infrastructure of the enemy capitalist state must be destroyed to get at the heart of the problem, and that is property, the means of production, class relations. Those things are responsible primarily for the oppression across the globe. And the kind of property relations George is talking about, revolutionaries historically have talked about, is the means of production. Who owns the oil? Who owns the hydro-thermal nuclear dam? Who owns the minerals under the earth? Who owns the resources on top of the earth, such as the vegetables, such as the water? Who owns this stuff? And that will determine the future if we can get a clear understanding of our enemies are not cats walking on the street. Our enemies are not the mom and pop store that is barely floating on water. Our primary principal enemy is the ruling class. They own the property. Everybody works for them. I don't care who you name. Everybody works for the ruling class. And if you don't work for McDonald's. You may work for a subsidiary over in Honduras where they pull tomatoes and bring them back to the United States. You know, if you don't work for a banana company, you may work for Chiquita. That is depriving brothers and sisters of Latin America of their use of their own land. So what I'm telling you is, it's the people at the top. Those are our oppressors. Now we have little flunkies that we would have to smack away when a revolution build. We have black traders, you have white traders, you have Latino traders that support the enemy state. They have a vested interest in maintaining the way that the system is set up right now. That's what George said. It must include the total suppression of all of those who think they have an outcome in the maintenance of the state. Clarence Thomas, he definitely believes he have an outcome in the maintaining the way the state is set up. Or the cats that wrote that Roe v. Wade report, they definitely have an outcome in maintaining the way the patriarchy is set up. So all of us have a vested interest in understanding property relations is the principal enemy. Otherwise, there's no revolution. Reshuffle the governmental personnel and forms. Without changing property relations and economic institutions, and you have produced simply another reform stage in the old bourgeois revolution. The power to alter the present imbalances, to remedy the critical defects of an advanced industrial state ordered on an antiquated set of greed, confused motives, rests with control over production and distribution of wealth. And that's what we talked about early on, brothers and sisters. That's what the struggle is about, power. The working class need to be in power, need to seize the state from the enemy, rip it up, shred it up, and develop a socialist one that will be more in harmony with developing justice, equality, and love all across this world. That's what it's about. It's about power. Don't tell me about no goddamn store. I don't care about a black business. I don't care about a Latino business. I care about how can we empower the people, the working class, the poor oppressed, to rise up and take control of their own destiny. If you could tell me how we could get to that stage, then we could talk. Like Fran Hampton said, don't come talking to me about peace if you ain't ready to die for it. So don't come talking to me about this enemy white supremacist state if you ain't ready to tackle it in a serious, honest, critical thinking kind of way. That's just simple revolutionary politics, brothers, one-on-one, and sisters, I apologize, one-on-one. The power to alter the present imbalances, to remedy the critical defects of an advanced industrial state ordered on an antiquated set of greed, confused motives, rests with control over the means of production and distribution of wealth. If the 1% who presently control the wealth of the society maintain their control after any reordering of the state, the changes cannot be said to be revolutionary. And here, Comrade George Jackson quotes John Jorasi. And it's a wonderful book, The Coming of the New International. I would recommend young comrades just coming into the revolution to read that. It's an autobiography of revolutionary movements in the late 60s and early 70s. John Jorasi did a good job of laying it out all across the world. So I would recommend young comrades, if you could get that book, The Coming of the New International, it will help you some in understanding what revolutionary organization looks like. The prerequisite for a successful popular revolution is that the victors totally jump the old machinery of state. Lenin stressed in The State and Revolution, quote, "One thing especially was proven by the commune, that the working class cannot simply lay hold of the ready-made state machinery and wield it for his own purposes, unquote. And again, the working class must break up, smash the ready-made state machinery and not confine itself merely to laying hold of it, unquote. Let me read that one more time, brothers and sisters, so we can be clear on this thing here, because I don't want to hear later on in the field we didn't understand that we're supposed to smash this state and not take it over and start distributing welfare like it's going to work for poor people. So let me just read this thing one more time. One thing was especially proven by the commune, that the working class cannot simply lay hold of the ready-made state machinery and wield it for its own purposes. And again, the working class must break up, smash the ready-made state machinery and not confine itself merely to laying hold of it, unquote. The reason is simple enough. A popular revolution means a revolution by and for the popular classes. Its ultimate aim is to bring all classes into one. That is, destroy the class state. Revolutionary change means the seizure of all that is held by the 1% and the transference of these brothers and sisters and comrades, of these holdings into the hands of the remaining 99%. If the 1% are simply displaced by another 1%, revolutionary change has not taken place. A social revolution after the fact of the modern corporate capitalist state can only mean the breakup of that state and a completely new form of economics and culture. As slaves, we understand that ownership and the mechanics of distribution must be reversed. Catch that, brothers and sisters. As slaves, as people on the bottom of the economic system, brothers and sisters, as the floor mat of the world, and I'm not ashamed to admit, we as African people have been the floor mat of the world ever since the European have assaulted Africa in 1492. How else can we look for a solution if we can't be objective? So I'm not afraid of recognizing and understand that I am a slave of this enemy system. So as slaves, we understand that ownership and the mechanics of distribution must be reversed. The problems of the Black colony and the Brown colony, those of the entire 99% who are being manipulated, can never be redressed as long as the necessary resources for their solution are the personal property of an extraneous minority motivated solely by the need for its own survival. And that extraneous, and other brothers and sisters, that just means small. Tiny. And that extraneous minority will never consider the proper solutions. We have on record from a voice speaking from inside the Fourth Reich, and he's talking about California, brothers and sisters, a lieutenant governor of California orating in public on poverty. Quote, one third of the population will always be ill-housed, ill-clothed, and ill-fed. Many urban problems are really conditions that we cannot change or do not want to incur the advantages of changing, unquote. His one-third statement was a calculated understatement, brothers and sisters and comrades. To the slave, revolution is an imperative, a love-inspired, conscious act of desperation. It's aggressive. It isn't cool or cautious. It's bold, audacious, violent, an expression of icy, disdainful hatred. It could be hardly any other way without raising a fundamental contradiction, brothers and sisters. So to the slave, as George said, revolution is a necessity. It's a love-inspired, conscious act of desperation. You, some of you brothers and sisters, read those stories of our comrades in the 1492 when they were in the decks of those slave ships, there were sharks following these slave boats so the parents can throw, the parents were throwing their kids, slave kids, over the boat. And the sharks, after a long period of time, raised their kids up on following the boat. And that's how the sharks began to survive. But our brothers who and sisters that was on that boat revolted. They fought back. They put a knife in the throat of their slave master on that boat. Some of them threw their kids over the boat in order to prevent them from coming into slavery in perpetuity. That is a conscious act of desperation. That is a moment where everything is on the table. You have nothing left but to give your life for the revolution. That's a conscious act. Huey called it revolutionary suicide. You know, where, think about that. If some of you comrades are Irish, remember the potato famine. Some of you comrades are Jewish and remember some of the atrocities of you have experienced. Some of you comrades are Latino and experienced some of the comprador brutality in Latin America, and also slavery as well under the Spanish. So you understand what we're talking about when we say it's a conscious act. When someone take over an embassy, that's, yeah, it's premeditated. Yeah, they sat down and thought about it. Yeah, they put resources to it, but it's also a conscious act. It's a crying out for attention. The Yemeni people, when they shoot rockets over into Saudi Arabia to blow up those oil fields, that's a conscious act of desperation. Look at us. Look what's happening. Look what's been happening to us for the last 10 years. That's a conscious act of desperation. When a man throws himself out of a prison cell, knowing he's going to die when he hit the ground, or a woman for that matter, since they're the fastest growing rate of imprisonment in the country. Those are conscious acts, brothers and sisters. That's not no weakness. And I apologize for speaking too harsh, brothers and sisters, but I wanted to emphasize that, you know, we on the right side of history. We on the right side of history. If revolution, and especially revolution in America, is anything less than an effective defense attack weapon and a charger for the people to mount now, it is meaningless to the great majority of the slaves. If revolution is tied to dependence on the inscrutabilities of long-range politics, it cannot be made relevant to the person who expects to die tomorrow. There could be no rigid time controls attached to the process that offers itself as relief. Not if those for whom it is principally intended are under attack right now. If the proponents of revolution cannot learn to distinguish and translate the theoretical into the practical, if they continue to debate just how to call up and harness the conscious motive forces of revolution, the revolutionary ideal will be the loser. It will be rejected. Think about that. Think about that. If folks continue to sit in their rooms and debate and turn this debate into dogmatism, which impedes turning it into practical results on the ground, the revolution is going to lose. That's what George was talking about here. You got to love the people to understand that the revolution can only survive if you do the right thing. Always do the right thing, even in the dark. Even in the dark. Be on the side of revolution. That's what he's saying here. The revolution will lose. Of course, obviously, subjectively, he's talking about the people as well. But the revolution is big. It's huge. It's an ideal that millions and millions of people around the world spilled blood to bring into fruition, to materialize into the lives of the people. You got to feel the revolution the same way some of you felt that spirit when you went into that church and stood up and danced and shook everywhere when you got the Holy Ghost. You got to feel the revolution like that. That's why Nelson Mandela could survive 27 years in the prison. He felt the revolution. I'm not talking about what he did when he came out. So I don't want Conrad saying, well, what happened post-apartheid? No, I'm not talking about post-apartheid. I'm talking about the 27 years he was in the belly of that white supremacist prison called Robben's Island. How could he survive and come out to live the 95 years old? It was the belief that revolution will change. It will change the conditions from one of being oppressed to that of being liberated. He believed that. Geronimo Jagger, G. Jagger Prop, believed that. Suniyati just got out, 49 years in prison. Ask yourselves, what made him survive that long? It's the faith and the belief in the people. It's the faith and the belief in the people. No longer how long this enemy may win a small victory here and there, we should never give up our belief and faith in the people. So brothers and sisters and comrades, and some enemies that may be listening as well, the principal reservoir of revolutionary potential in America lies in wait inside the Black colony. Its sheer numerical strength, its desperate historical relation to the balance of the productive system, and the fact of its present status in the creation of wealth forced the Black stratum at the base of the whole class structure into the forefront of any revolutionary scheme. All that is saying, brothers and sisters, is that Black people must be their own liberators. White people must be their liberators. Our brown brothers and sisters must be their own liberators. We ain't here to dictate to another group how you should conduct yourself within your community. We believe in self-determination. We're saying, okay, here's the model. Here's the blueprint. This is what we know works. And that's all we're going to hand you. We're not going to say do it this way or do it that way. Because in the movement, brothers and sisters, we have a thing called self-reliance. They used to call it juche. It's a Korean term. The Panthers popularized it in their papers. Juche only means self-reliance. That's all. Self-reliance. So when you are in Washington, D.C., when you are in the Appalachian Mountains, you shouldn't look to comrades across the country to help solve the problems in your community. You should use what you have there to start the process, and then solidarity will come later on. That's how you organize. Get out there, 2-3 people. Do whatever you need to do. People will show up later on because they're gonna recognize that you're on the right side of history. And that's what George is saying here. That's all. The people at the bottom, they must have their own leadership. The working class must have its own leadership. That's it, period. 30% of all industrial workers are Black. Close to 40% of all industrial support roles are filled by Blacks. Blacks are still doing the work of the greatest slave state in history. The terms of our servitude are all that has that, excuse me, brothers and sisters, the terms of our servitude are all that have been altered. The Black colony can and will influence the fate of things to come in the USA. The impact of Black revolutionary rage actually could carry at least the opening stages of a socialist revolution under certain circumstances, not discounting some of the complexities created by the specter of racism. However, if we are ever going to be successful in tying Black energy and rage to the international socialist revolution, we must understand that racial complexities do exist. Catch that, brothers and sisters. You know how some of these cultural pork chop culture nationalists love to say, oh, the black communists, you know, they have relationships with everybody. You know, they sell out to the whites. They sell out to the Latinos. Oh, they just slavish towards the Arabs. That's how they talk about us, because they know what real revolution consists of. And they use the racial complexities to divide the community, to divide you and I. They keep us arguing over who's gonna own a store down the street, or who's gonna own a piece of abandoned property up the street, while they continue to rake resources in the trillions around the world. So we got to stay focused. When the Minister of Defense and servant of the people, Huey P. Newton, attacks the strategy of the American Communist Party and the left liberal revisionists for their failure to devise a policy which takes into account the special circumstances of Yankee-style racism, he is not attacking communism and the collective ideal. Think about that, how many of you have been given false information about Huey P. Newton, our great-great brother who founded the original Black Panther Party. In fact, who has founded our party as well, since he is one of the leading theoreticians of the Panther Revolution. But think about what they said about he's a nationalist, you know, or he wasn't a communist. Here's they're telling you right here, look, when the Minister of Defense and servant of the people, Huey P. Newton, attacks the strategy of the American Communist Party and the liberal left revisionists for their failure to devise a policy which takes into account the special circumstances of Yankee-style racism, he is not attacking communism and the collective ideal. He is questioning the Communist Party and other less committed sections of the left revolutionary movement about their awareness of the unique problems presented by a particularly vicious and immediately threatening racism. Come on, brothers and sisters. Racism is a real thing. It's a material effect. It exists. There's two kinds of it. There's the overt and there's the covert. The overt is burning a cross on your land. The overt is we don't want you in this neighborhood. The overt is neo-Nazis walking down the street and breaking up a rally for homelessness or something to that effect. You see that stuff. You can visualize it. Your paws can see it. Your heart can see it. But the more insidious form of racism is the covert. And you don't see that. We don't see that. The redlining of communities, the denying of Black and Indigenous and brown people access to the Homestead Act. You know what the Homestead Act did. It was passed by Congress that whites all over the country will be giving an advance sets of money where they could set up their own land, their own garden, their own house, and the government will pay for it. But Blacks and Indigenous people were simply left on reservations. That's right, that's what it was. We were both on reservations. So what I'm saying, brothers and sisters, attacking another organization's ideological weakness does not mean you're attacking the red flag. And don't let nobody deceive you that you're attacking the red flag when you call out Bob Avakian and their so-called Communist Party. You're not attacking the red flag when you call out some of the less committed comrades in the Himalayas that are in government over there and not supporting the armed struggle by Bahia in the field. You're not attacking the red flag when you call out and question some of the less committed cats in India and Philippines or right here in North New Jersey or New York or Harlem or the Appalachian Mountains. You're not attacking communism. You're questioning their strategy as to how to deal with race within a society that loves to divide the people along those classifications. Race is a social construct. You and I, if we get together, we could deconstruct it. But first it starts with serious commitment to overturning this enemy system. My brother Jonathan, a communist revolutionary to the core, writing me in June of 1969, theorized as follows. Quote, we are quite obviously faced with the need to organize some small defenses to the more flagrant abuses of the system now. Now, comrades, brothers and sisters, Jonathan is only 16 at the time, well, 17 at the time that he was writing this stuff to his brother, George Jackson, who was in prison. So catch this, brothers and sisters, 17 years old. Quote, we are quite obviously faced with the need to organize some small defenses to the more flagrant abuses of the system now. I mean this in a military sense. The period of disorganized activities, of riots and rallies, and purely political agitation, education has come to a close. The violence of the enemy, the opposition, has brought it to an end. We cannot raise consciousness another millimeter without a new set of tactics. Long-range political ploys alone are not practical for us. To me, the concept stems, excuse me, brothers and sisters, long-range political ploys alone are not practical for us. To me, the concept seems to assume that someday in the distant future, we'll produce a 700-pound fleet to fight the paper tiger. That's not too likely to happen. While we await the precise moment when all of capitalism's victims will indignantly rise to destroy the system, we are now being devoid in family lots at the whim of this thing. There will be no super slave. Some of us are going to have to take courage in our hand and build a hard revolutionary cadre for selective retaliatory violence. We had numbers on our side if the whites who support revolutionary change can prevent this thing from degenerating into race war. The picture of the United States as a paper tiger is quite accurate, but there is a great deal of work to be done on its destruction. And I'm of the opinion that if there's a big job of growing to do, the sooner begun, the sooner done. Now, brothers and sisters and comrades, I said earlier how old he was. Keep that in mind, 17 years old. And I'm going to read this passage and then open it up for 10 minutes for our brothers and sisters and comrades to chime in and give us their assessment, not simply of what we studied so far, but any current ideas, any current news, any political projects that you are doing in your community. Try to tie in what we read to that particular thing so we can get some concrete, wrap some of this theory around some concrete conditions out in the communities at large. Both Huey and Jonathan are understandably calling for the program revolution to take into account the fact of racial genocide. Jonathan is calling from his grave, adding another voice to the many thunderous graveyard affirmations, which for us Blacks speed the revolution to its ultimate issue. In order to develop revolutionary consciousness, we must learn how revolutionary consciousness can be raised to the highest point by stimuli from the vanguard elements. We recognize and appreciate the decades of hard, sometimes dangerous work done in the name of the revolution by the older socialist parties. Perhaps we wouldn't exist at all were it not for their efforts. It is our sincere wish to operate in complete harmony with these older groups. but we must create new impetus and greater intellectual and physical energy if the forces of reaction are not to win another extended reprieve. So brothers and sisters and comrades, I just want to talk briefly about this right here. The old guard should be regarded with respect. The old guard should be regarded with a great deal of inspiration. They were the first examples. And we're talking about the early 1900s here in the United States. That's what George is talking about. And not just talking about the American Communist Party that was huge at that time. He's talking about those communists and socialists in Alabama who were Black, who were unionizing in the early 1900s. He's talking about those folks as well. He's talking about when the stock market crashed in 1929 and socialism was on the lips of the whole country. You was an anarchist or you was a communist or you was just simply a person fed up with capitalism. You embraced socialism to a certain extent. That was where it was at its height in the 1930s and 40s. And we have to look back and study that period in order to learn from its mistakes and to build upon its successes. So that's all George is saying. You can read Malcolm X, but learn from Malcolm's mistakes, learn from Malcolm's victories. You can read George Jackson or Huey P. Newton or Assata Shakur. You can read Reactionary. Whoever you read, learn something from that so it can benefit and impact the revolution, impact the conditions in our community. We recognize and appreciate the decades of hard, sometimes dangerous work done in the name of revolution by the older socialist parties. However, a joint effort will make the task of overwhelming our common enemy all the simpler. But if our present differences, brothers and sisters and comrades, cannot be reconciled by an honest and fearless search for the correct way, then we will be forced to take the foundation of corrective ideals and theory into our own hands and build a positive and more practical superstructure applicable to the circumstances surrounding our lives. That's all. If you're a part of an organization and you got people in the organization that are hindering it from moving forward, then you may have to move away from those individuals and keep the integrity of the revolution alive as long as you is built upon the correct ideas. Correct ideas. In his guerrilla warfare, Lenin wrote, "New forms of struggle, unknown to the participants of the giving period, inevitably arise as the giving social situation changes. The coming crisis will introduce new forms of struggle that we are now unable to foresee." Catch that, brothers and sisters. The coming crisis of capitalism and prayer. Well, we already know it's in crisis. And Lenin was talking 100 years ago. We say in the Panther Revolution that capitalism is in crisis. That's why it's unleashing chaos and anarchy around the world. It's trying to consolidate its power. But everywhere it's going, it's causing chaos because they want control of that oil in the Middle East. They want to smack down some of these emerging economies like China. Well, China's a developed economy, but still emerging. They want to smack down Russia. That's why they say, our objective is not a peace deal with Ukraine. Our objective is a weakened Russia. That's been their objective all along. And Russia is not a socialist. Russia is not a communist. They are junior and partners of the imperialist global system. That's the position that Russia forms within the global capitalist order. They are junior capitalists. United States is the big dog, the chairman of the International Confederation of Thieves. And they determine who joins the World Bank. who joins the the IMF. They determine who go into the mines of the Congo and bring out the gold and bring out the coltan. It's these international capitalists with the United States at the head of the pyramid dictating this thing. And that's why they're trying to corral and control China. They got over 800 military bases around the world. 800 military bases. Almost 500 of those military bases are either pointed at Iran or pointed at China. Look at it on the map, brothers and sisters. I'm not being making hyperbole. Look at the map. Majority of the United States military bases on land, air, and water are either pointed at Iran or pointed at China. So new forms of struggle unknown to the participants of the given period inevitably arise as the given social situation changes. The coming crisis will introduce new forms of struggle that we are now unable to foresee. In other words, the old guard must not fail to understand that circumstances change in time and space, that there could be nothing dogmatic about revolutionary theory. It is born out of each popular struggle. Catch that, comrades. There's nothing dogmatic about revolutionary theory. It is born out of the conditions in your community. If you got bad housing, that's where your revolutionary theory should come from. If the police knock you in the head of your community, your revolutionary theory of fighting back should come from that social condition. Everybody who are revolutionaries should look at their community, find a condition, organize around that. That's all he is saying. There's nothing dogmatic about revolutionary theory. It is born out of each popular struggle. Each popular struggle must be analyzed historically to discover new ideas. Thank you, comrade. Each popular struggle must be analyzed historically to discover new ideas. In the words of John Gerasi, building from one to the other, eventually the revolutionary cadre will become equipped with the theory rooted in experience, brought in by historical knowledge, tested by combat, and fortified by reflection. That's how you build a hard core of revolutionaries, a solid core, building from one to the other. Eventually, the revolutionaries that come together will be equipped with a theory rooted in experience, brought in by historical knowledge, tested by combat, and fortified by reflection. And all the revolutionaries on this phone have been tested by combat. All of you have been to demonstrations before. All of you, and some of you still love to be pepper sprayed in the face when you at demonstrations, because you're out there fighting. You're out there fighting for the people. So you're being tested and you're getting stronger. Each time the enemy push you down, you get stronger. Each time the enemy corral us 100 miles from their convention, we get stronger because we develop new tactics now of how to get closer the next time. So brothers and sisters, we don't need 100 sheep to go into the streets to effectuate some kind of change. We only need 10 determined panthers to go into the streets, fortified and equipped with power to the people. I'm going to ask our chairman, Jake, to go ahead and open the floor up for 10 minutes so the brothers and sisters can go ahead and exchange ideas, theories, views.
Yeah, so
thank you, comrade. We're going to ask comrades to go ahead and chime in and try to tie what we've studied so far in your community. All power to the people. Go ahead, comrade Jake.
Yeah, so we're going to open the floor. So just try to connect whatever you might have on your mind to the material here. Give us your thoughts, these kinds of things. All right, anyway, the floor's open. So you feel free to speak.
Hey, comrades. So I took from the text where George Jackson says the impact of Black revolutionary rage actually could carry at least the opening stages of the socialist revolution under certain circumstances. And we definitely saw that, you know, in the last couple of years with the BLM movement. And I think that, you know, that's one like modern, you know, real life example most of us have witnessed. And during a lot of those actions and marches, there were a lot of connections made. I lived in Michigan at the time. In the last year, moved to Oklahoma, but I was connected on the ground there. And during the, you know, a lot of the actions and events, you know, of course, organizers and people that are involved, you know, get to know each other. And the connections that grew from like revolutionary socialist, anti-fascist organizations and organizers and folks that were involved in like more of like the community level organizing is like part of what's important and how that happens, you know, how that like how that would happen, how that that rage and that movement would get, you know, connected to, we see it get connected to the socialist movement. And over the next couple of years, you know, community groups that were organizing, like an example was the Detroit March for Black Women, reached out to white anti-fascist groups and asked for us to provide security to put ourselves on the front lines between the hate groups that would come and the police and such. And so, I mean, that was like one way in which we saw like that kernel of revolutionary involvement connecting with that, you know, with BLM, or as George Jackson says, you know, with Black rage, Black revolutionary rage. That's it.
Yeah, I will say that, you know, one other comparison that I would put it to, and, you know, I think that your example is more, is closer to what I think George Jackson's talking about here, because it was a national movement. And this other thing that I'm going to bring up too is also a national movement, but it was smaller on the extent of the rage when it comes to the national level. The LA riots with Rodney King, I think that was a very clear expression, at least locally, of Black rage. And, you know, that the tensions there between the different racial groups, it was lacking some solidarity in the same, you know, when you compare it to the Black Lives Matter movement, you know, Black Lives Matter movement had you know, broader lines on solidarity there. Whereas in LA, it was kind of just an unorganized, you know, shootout and riot and, you know, whereas if there was existing organizations in the community, revolutionary organizations, in the white community, you know, in the Black community, in the Asian community, Latino community in LA at the time, they could have captured that rage and put it toward, you know, an actual uprising in the city of LA, like a organized, you know, concerted, democratically based, you know, centralized leadership. They could have taken that city over, actually. And, you know, you saw that kind of a thing. You know, the thing of the Black Lives Matter thing is it's decentralized. And the same thing goes with most anti-fascist organizations that tend to be anarchist. So they operate in these kind of voluntary cells where there's no leadership. And that they're just connected on, you know, a voluntary basis. So they have organization to it, but it's not, there was nobody leading that movement on a national level. Like, you didn't have a Malcolm X or a Martin Luther King of that movement. And it was kind of spontaneous in the sense that, you know, people were responding to the violence, but they weren't mobilized by existing organizations, right? Like, to some extent they were, right? But the driving motivator here was actually what they saw on video. You know, they weren't compelled by the nature of, you know, a capitalist system. They were compelled by the violence that they had saw. Whereas, you know, and I actually can't think of a good example in the US of this off the top of my head, modern day, where, you know, an organization has gone into a community and just, you know, without some egregious violence or something like that, mobilized people, you know, in the thousands around some issue. It's usually in response to something. What we want to do is we don't want there to have to be a tragedy to mobilize people. And that's usually what it takes in this country. We want people to recognize that there are tragedies every single day. The whole entire system, you know, your exploitation, the very nature of your relationship with the work that you perform in society, that's exploitation. And it happens millions of times across, you know, the whole country every single day. And that's not a motivating factor for people to go out into the streets in mass. And it's surprising, but that's what we want to be able to mobilize people to do. But anyway, I'm on a tangent at this point. Go ahead, Tom.
Well, one thing I think Jonathan didn't understand at 17, and I didn't understand at 17, is that the nature of the struggle is protracted. It's a generational struggle. It's a struggle that, you know, Marx started 200 some years ago, and it's still the new kid on the block. It's still, you know, each generation is a fresh revolutionary movement coming up. And Mao once said that the logic of the people is to fight, to fail, to fight, to fail, to fight, to fail, again and again, until we win. And that the period that Jonathan was in was an upsurge period, and it was followed by a long period of reaction, where the movement was getting smaller and less toothsome, and reactionaries were getting stronger and stronger. Now we're in another period of upsurge, and the Black Lives Matter thing showed that the masses of people, without any political education per se, without any real organization, can turn out in their millions to protest against the outrageousness of the police state, against the outrageousness of imperialist war, and you know, all of the ills of capitalism, against capitalism itself. I was in England when they had a million people surround the Parliament and anti-capitalist May Day, and that was a tremendous, you know, ideological, political shock to the imperialist system. But without the the party and the revolutionary forces organized to the level where we can take the initiative. These things are like a sea that rises up in a storm and then calms down. And you have to start over again the next time the wind blows. And when you reach a stage when you become a conscious force, then, you know, you've got thousands of armed Red Guards at your disposal, and you've got mutinies going on in the military, and you've got the ability to actually seize power and to wield it. But even that's a protracted struggle, because you can't do everything you want to do in the first year. You know, it takes each year you got to try to get more accomplished towards achieving your goal of classless society. But in the meantime, you can't change everything. You have to make compromises in reality. You got to keep people eating, you know, you got to keep the food supply going. You got to keep an economy running, even though you don't have the ability to completely change it yet. You change as much as you can each year, you know, and fight against the counter revolutionary movements. But when Mao talks about, you know, world revolution being not far off, he's not negating that, you know, this long protracted struggle, but pointing out that shit comes to a head, just like the water starts to boil at a certain temperature. And it's a qualitatively different thing going down. We're like a stone's throw from World War III. It could start. And in fact, the NATO forces, part of their agreement is that they will support a nuclear strike if any of those countries are attacked by a outside country. In the UN Charter, you know, they're not going to wait for the Russians to throw a nuclear weapon. All they have to do is bring Ukraine into NATO, and they have a pretext to launch all their weapons at once. You know, we're not at all in a stage where we could just, you know, sit back and build a movement in our leisure. We're in a stage where if we don't get shit together quickly enough, ain't going to be no people running around, because everybody's going to be in a bomb shelter. And that ain't last long, because most of those people are going to die. You know, we're not prepared for war, let alone for revolution. But yet shit's happening, and we have to catch up with the times. That's just what I want to say.
So we got somebody with their hand raised.
That's me, it's Rob. I don't know if my name's showing up. I just wanted to add that George, he didn't do that just alone in a cell with some books on theory. It's his correspondence with a lot of the comrades on the outside that helped sharpen his ideology. And you see that with his correspondence with his brother or any of the other Panthers or anybody else. I believe he had correspondence with Angela Davis at a point. And that's where I think that it's imperative to help when we do start organizing and help pushing forward revolutionary theory that includes the lumping from the inside. And because I know a lot nowadays, it's a lot harder to get those books on the inside, and having that level of correspondence with someone else from the outside and the inside, and that building of back and forth, and that practice from back and forth, is going to help strengthen the bonds on both sides. I just wanted to add that.
All power. So we got a little bit more time here. Anybody want to chime in?
I would like to comment. Power to the people. I agree with what Brother Robbins, Comrade Rob is saying. It is hard to get the books, not only on the inside, but also on the outside, because I think what Brother George was doing was trying to create something not only within, but also so it would span outside to where he was. If you really look at the history, especially when he was in San Quentin, he had a few people partnered with. They all got together and dialogue and then went forward. Now, I think we should do the same thing here. I think, let's look at it today. Let's fast forward to today. I think that's like the same thing now. I think we wait for the moment, I think. But I think in the meantime, right, with George Floyd, they had the march with Black Lives Matter. And I'm glad with Black Lives Matter what they did. But since then, none has happened. We go to spare the moment, and then after that, we stop. But we had to continue. Once we start, we had to continue to march forward to create something. It's like turning the water on. Okay, then turn it off, like a faucet. We can't just continue to just turn it on and then shut it off. We got to turn it on, leave it on, until we get some results. That's the key in about revolution. You want to get results. And until we get everybody on the same page and to understand what's before us, we can see some results. Yes, it takes time. Yes, this is a work in progress, but it can be done if you get everybody together and again, educate them. Once you educate them, and once you have them thinking, open up, and get into consciousness and come out of that box the way capitalism has trained them, you're going to see some results.
I don't know what the comrade name is that was just speaking, but I agree with you. We have been marching, Comrade Chris, thank you. We have been marching for years and years and years. And when I think of, the situation with like the public servants, the pigs and things and how they carry it in society, just killing people, shooting people in the back of their heads, because they want to. And then they have this qualified immunity and things of that nature. Yes, people are angry. I know I'm angry and I'm tired and I don't feel like marching anymore. I want to exactly. do something that is going to actually bring change about. So then you look at these systems like your legislation, your constitutional systems, your political systems, and all this stuff, all these different systems that need to be attacked and torn down. So you're trying to deal with what was, what is, and making a plan for the future all at one time. It's like, how do you do it all? How do you come up with a plan that is actually going to for a change get an outcome? It's almost impossible to get people together on the same page. It's really hard to bring people together because everybody wants to be a chief and nobody wants to be an Indian. It's really hard.
That's right.
Everybody. And so, this is my experiences, and I was thinking about, because today is the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan's birthday. I'm not Muslim by any chance, but I'm a native Washingtonian. And I remember that very one day where all of these people came together, all of these men came together. It wasn't just melanated brothers. I mean, it was all colored men there. And it was beautiful. Everybody was happy. Everybody was in solidarity. Food was flying everywhere. Everybody was having a good time. I mean, so what kind of organizing, needs to take place to get to a point like that, not for just one day of a million man march or anything, but
yeah,
to make it last forever. Because like with the George Floyd case, you know, we all seen what happened on television. The young lady recorded it. We seen what happened. Okay, then they took it to court, wasted taxpayer dollars to go through this trial mess and all of this. Okay, so now, after the family get peanuts thrown at them, they take it and they tell you, hey, we just want to be okay and we want everybody to calm down. And then it's over and everybody go on about their business like nothing happened until the next person gets shot 2 days later. So what are we going to do about that?
Let me comment on what my sister Comrade said. I heard something what Dr. King said on a video this morning, really, really had me thinking. He said, we've been marching so long, no, waiting for so long. Wait, marching, and nothing. Nothing. And I thought about that thing. We've been marching and dialoguing and everything, and there's no result. Let's find a solution. What is the my question to everybody out there is, what is the solution to deal to kill this cancer?
I do want to propose something just briefly. Think about it this way, okay? There's only so long that they can pull back people's rights and antagonize
right.
people and kill them, throw them in jail, before people start to drop their liberal mindset, okay? So in some sense, it is inevitable. Okay? But we want to be more scientific. We want to be able to give the masses organizations that they can use to solve their problem directly. So in your local community, if you ask the question, where do you start? It's with the primary problem. Right. So if, you know, just as George Jackson Chaka were saying here, if housing is the main problem in your community, that's where you start. Right. And then the masses come along with that because you begin to solve that problem. So on the one hand, you have people, you have the government and capitalists who are going to repeatedly use their domination of the state to repress the proletariat, which is all of us. And in that, they're going to take your rights away. They're going to throw you in jail. They're going to tear gas you. They're going to beat you up. They're going to shoot you, all these things, right? Well, people are going to get radicalized by it. The state sows the seeds of its own destruction, right? The capitalist state does that. Imperialism as a broader thing does that. But on the other hand, you have the professional revolutionaries who build the organizations and who network the resources, right, to arm with radicalized people, right? And then through our social practice, people are also radicalized. So the state is going to give you the means of its own destruction, but you're also going to build the means of the state's destruction at the same time. Wanted to offer that to you.
Back in here.
I think we got to start with the first question is, what is capitalism? You know, capital, as Marx defined it, as one law. It's a one-trick pony. And that is that capital is drawn like the steel filings to a magnet to wherever the rate of profit on investment is highest. And most of the strongest and most ruthless will fight and kill and murder and cause war or whatever to gain control of those areas of maximum rate of profit. And they will do whatever nasty tricks they have to do to push up the rate of profit. And they don't, capital does not give a fuck about anybody's welfare. Its sole trick is to concentrate capital where it can come to its most productive, where it reproduces itself the fastest. But cancer, its only concern is growing itself. Now, a socialist system is a command economy where capital is controlled by the masses of people and allocated where we need it to make things happen. For example, if we want everybody to eat, then we allocate funds to make sure that everybody on the planet gets a decent breakfast, lunch, and dinner, particularly the children. If we want to make a priority of healthcare, then we allocate capital to wherever is needed to ensure that everybody gets the highest quality healthcare science can provide, free. Well, it's not totally free because the state has to allocate the money and the workers have to create the wealth. So, but in a workers' society, the workers who create the wealth have democratically ability to control how their wealth is used so that it serves the best interests of society and humanity. That's the complete opposite of what capitalism is. To get to where we were, capitalism, we have to protest and fight and march and riot and strike and do all the things we can to build the struggle. But ultimately, we have to create the force to overthrow it and kick it to the curb and put it to bed forever. And then create a system where the workers democratically decide how we're going to move forward into the future. And what are our priorities going to be? How are we going to make sure that we don't get corrupted by what power exists under that system? How do we make sure that the people at the bottom continually have the strongest voice in the party and in the operations? The power has to come from the most oppressed because they've got the most interest in ending all oppression. As long as there's somebody on the bottom, you know, there's a reason to keep changing society. Because those who after a revolution very often lose their revolutionary zeal. You know, they were tough fighters in 1917, but by 1929, they're a comfortable bureaucrat.
We jump in here, Comrade Tom. Thank you for that wonderful announcement.
Can we just put in Nicholas here? He's got something he wanted to say. I think he's been waiting.
Go ahead.
All right.
I just want to say one of the actions that could be made like now, since some states like Louisiana and I think some other neo-Confederate states, one action that maybe they're trying to get rid of contraceptives. So I think a great networking thing for us to do is to, if we can, get a way to fundraise for like Plan B and contraceptives and stuff. And that can be a thing that we can do to give out, because that's an immediate action now. Since if the, because it's going to look like they're going to overturn it anyway.
You went out, Comrade Nick. We can't hear you. All right, we have another comrade had their hand up. We're gonna make this the last one so we can get into this last part of study. I seen a hand up. I don't know who it was, but maybe Chick, you can let that person in so they can chime in. Oh, power to book on with the study. So what I'm going to do here, brothers and sisters, because we're coming up on an hour and a half, I'm going to end this here on Fallen Comrade. This is a piece that Minister Huey wrote about George Jackson and his death. And it's a conversation between Huey and George Jackson, because here Huey talks to George, and I would assume the last letter that he received from George Jackson, at least one of the last significant communiques he received from his field marshal, who was George Jackson. So the Black Panther is our brother and son, the one who wasn't afraid. George Jackson, Soledad brother. Fallen Comrade. George Jackson had genius. And brothers and sisters and comrades, this is Huey P. Newton again. And Revolutionary Suicide. We have that book, so if comrades need it, all you gotta do is tap into Jake, he can get you access to this book. George Jackson had genius. Genius is rare enough and should be treasured. But when genius is combined in the Black man with revolutionary passion and vision, the establishment will cut him down. Comrade Jackson understood this. He knew his days were numbered and were prepared to die as a true believer in revolutionary suicide. For 11 years, he insisted on remaining free in a brutal prison system. All along, he resisted the authorities and encouraged his brothers in prison to join him. The enemy state retaliated. Parole was continually refused. Solitary confinement was imposed on him for 7 years. Threats on his life were frequent from guards, from inmates who called themselves, quote, Hitler's helpers, unquote. From knife thrusts and pick handles of faceless, sadistic pigs. And finally, they murdered him. After all of that, brothers and sisters, this is just a sentence, and I still get emotional when I read that. I'm gonna read this little small paragraph again. He said, the state retaliated. This is Huey P. Newton. Parole was continually refused. Solitary confinement was imposed on him for 7 years. This means locked inside of a cell with another lock and door so no one could get in. The only person that could open up those two doors were a lieutenant, not another prisoner. He couldn't, all he could hear is the cries of the brothers who went psychotic, the beatings at night from the guards when no one was looking. That's all he could hear. And remember our last study, comrades, he said, I would be talking to my book. I would be talking to an author. And then I will wake up and still find myself communicating to this author about revolutionary politics, ideas, tactics, struggles. You know, this is what this man faced. So we reading about this stuff, we have the luxury to read about it. But think about that little passage right there, where he said, in the months before his death, everything began to close in. He was one of the few prisoners who was shackled and heavily guarded for his infrequent trips to the visitor's room. On attempts, brothers and sisters, attempts, murder attempts on his life became almost daily occurrences. But he never gave in or retreated. Prison was the crucible that shaped his spirit And George often used the words of Ho Chi Minh to describe his resistance. Calamity has hardened me and turned my mind to steel. I knew him like a brother, Huey P. Newton is saying. At first, I knew him only spiritually, through his writings and his legend in the prison system. When I was at the penal colony and he was at Soledad, then not long after my arrival, I received through the prison grapevine a request from George to join the Black Panther Party. It was easily granted, no questions asked. George was made a member of the People's Revolutionary Army with the rank of general and field marshal. For the next 3 years, we were in constant communication by means of messages carried by friends and lawyers and inmates transferred from one prison to another. Despite the restrictions of the prison system, we managed to transmit our messages on paper and on tapes. Among George's contributions to the party were his articles he wrote for the Black Panther newspaper, which furthered our revolutionary theory and provided inspiration for all the brothers and sisters. In February 1971, I received this letter from him. February 21st, 1971. Comrade Huey, things are quiet here. Tonight we have discipline and accord. Tomorrow all may fly apart again, but that's us. I have two articles that I would like to be put in the paper, one following the other by a week. The one on Angela Davis first. Then, if you approve, I would like to contribute something to the paper every week or whenever you have space for me. If yes, let me know if there is any area in particular you would like me to cover, comment on. Then do I comment as observer or participant? One favor, please don't let anyone delete the things I say or change them around. I don't need an editor. Unless what I say is not representative of the party line, don't let anyone change a word. When I make an ideological error, of course, correct it to fit the party's position. And don't let them shorten or condense. If something is too long, part one, part two. This is yours speaking, comrades from the grave. If you want to use me to say nasty things about those who deserve it, it may be best for me to comment as an observer. That way, less contradictions between yourself and people you may have to work with. You told Blank that you and I had, quote, a misunderstanding, unquote, once, but that it was cleared up. When was it that we misunderstood each other? Be very careful of messages or any word that has supposed to have come from me. I really don't recall any misunderstanding. People lie for many reasons. Try to memorize my handwriting. That is how all messages will come in the future, if we have a future. Did you know that Angela Davis and I were married a while back? And I had almost pulled her all the way into the Black Panther Party just before Eldridge Cleaver made that statement. I had done so well that the Communist Party tried to cut our contacts, attack my sanity in little whispers and looks and conversing with her. And they cut off my paid subscriptions to their two newspapers. Strange that they would be afraid of the FBI and not afraid of the Black Cat. perhaps they reached an understanding with the FBI, some of them anyway, is blank Communist Party. Man, what's happening with her? She has no control of her mouth or ego. Arrange for a good contact or write and seal messages with a dumb print. I have ideas I'd like to leave with you all. Thanks, brother, for helping us. Beautiful, hard, disciplined brothers are in here. And I can't wait for the day to deliver them to you. Comrade George. In the last 3 years of Comrade Jackson's life, he felt sustained and supported by the Black Panther Party. He has struggled alone for so long to raise the consciousness of Black inmates. And his example encouraged thousands who were weaker and less intrepid than he. But the price he paid in alienation and reprisals were fearsome. Within the party, he was no longer alone. He became part of a burgeoning and invincible revolutionary liberation movement. In his second book, Blood in My Eye, he expressed this faith, quote, "The Black Panther Party is the largest and most powerful political force existing outside establishment politics. It draws this power from the people. It is the people's natural political vanguard," unquote. George asked the party to publish his first book, Soledad Brother. But in the difficult negotiations between go-betweens and without direct contact, the arrangements fell through. To make sure this mistake would never happen again, he left his entire will and estate and all of his writings to the party, the Black Panther Party. More important than that, he bequeathed us his spirit and his love. George's funeral was held in Oakland on August 28, 1971, exactly 1 week after his murder at St. Augustine's Episcopal Church, pastored by Father Earl Neal. A crowd of about 7,000 friends gathered to pay their last respects to our fallen comrade. And the Black Panther Party had a large contingent of comrades on hand to handle the crowd and protect the Jackson family. I arrived at the church shortly before the funeral cortege. The second floor sanctuary was empty, but from the window, I could see the crowd stretching for more than a block in each direction, filling every available space and closing off the streets to motor traffic. A number of Black Panthers sat talking quietly downstairs. Occasionally, they relieved the comrades who were controlling the crowd and directing traffic outside. The children from the Intercommunal Youth Institute were there, and although they had been in the building since early morning, they did not complain of weariness. The children felt the loss of George deeply. When they had learned of his death the previous week, all of them had written messages of condolences to his mother. They loved George, and in their faces, I could see their determination to grow up and fulfill his dreams of liberation. Tensions were high. We had received many threats the previous week from prison guards, from police, and from many others, stating that the funeral would not be held. And if it was, there would be calls for more funerals for Black Panthers. We were ready for anything. The comrades were angry about the threats, and they were righteously angry about the continued oppression of the poor and Black people who lived in this land. You can see it in their faces, in their measured, firm strides, in their clenched fists, in their voices as they greeted the hearse with shouts of power to the people, power to the people. Long live the spirit of George Jackson. Long live the spirit of George Jackson. When the funeral arrived, Bobby and I prepared to meet the people in it as they entered the door of the church. It was the first time Bobby and I had shared a platform in over 4 years. But there was no cause for rejoicing. We said nothing to each other. We knew only too well what the other was thinking. As the casket bearing the body of Comrade George was brought to the sanctuary, a song was playing, Nina Simone, "I Wish I Knew How It Was or How It Feels to Be Free." Inside the church walls were ringed with Black Panthers carrying shotguns. George had said that he wanted no flowers at his funeral, only shotguns. In honoring his request, we was also protecting his family and all those who were dedicated to carrying on his spirit. Any person who entered that sanctuary with the purpose of starting some madness would know that he did not stand a chance of going very far. In death, even as in life, George thought about the best interests of his companions. Father Earl Neal made a short but powerful statement about the lesson of George Jackson's death, that Black people will have to get off their knees and take their destiny in their own hands. Bobby read some of the many messages from around the world. Elaine Brown sang, "One time's too much to tell any man that he's not free." And I know I butchered that, but I gave it a chance. And I delivered the eulogy, which went in part, quote, "George Jackson was my hero. He set a standard for prisoners, political prisoners, for people. He showed the love, the strength, the revolutionary fervor characteristic of any soldier for the people. He inspired prisoners, whom I later encountered, to put his ideas into practice, and so his spirit became a living thing. Today I say that although George's body had fallen, his spirit goes on because his ideas live. And we will see that these ideas stay alive because they're manifested in our bodies and in these young Panthers' bodies who are our children. So it's a true saying that there will be revolution from one generation to the next. This was George's legacy, and he will go on. He will go on into immortality because we believe that the people will win. We know the people will win as they advance generation upon generation. What kind of standard did George Jackson set? Here we eulogize brothers and sisters and comrades. First, he was a strong man without fear, determined, full of love, strength, and dedication to the people's cause. He led a life that we must praise. No matter how he was oppressed, no matter how wrongly he was done, he still kept the love for the people. And if this is why he felt no pain in giving up his life for the people's cause. Even after his death, George Jackson is a legendary figure and a hero. Even the oppressor, the fascist, the imperialist, the capitalist, the scum of the earth realizes this. To cover their murder, they say that George Jackson killed 5 people, 5 oppressors, and wounded 3 in the space of 30 seconds. You know, comrades, brothers and sisters, sometimes I like to overlook the fact that this would be physically impossible. But after all, George Jackson is my hero, and I would like to think that it was possible. I would be very much happy thinking that George Jackson had the strength, because that would have made him Superman. Of course, my hero would have to be like Superman. And we will raise our children to be like George Jackson, to live like George Jackson, to fight for freedom as George Jackson fought for freedom. George's last statement, brothers and sisters, the example of his conduct at San Quentin on that terrible day left a standard for political prisoners and for the prisoner society of racist reactionary America. He left a standard for the liberation armies of the world. He showed us how to act. He demonstrated how the unjust would be criticized by the weapon. And this will certainly be true because the people would take care of that. George also said, brothers and sisters, that the oppressor is very strong and he might beat him down. He might beat us all down to our very knees. He might crush us to the ground. But it will be physically impossible for the oppressor to go on. At some point, his legs will get tired. And when his legs get tired, then George Jackson and the people will tear his kneecaps off. So we will be very practical, brothers and sisters. We won't make statements and believe the things the enemy prison officials say. There are incredible stories about one man killing five people in 30 seconds. We will go on and live very realistically. There will be pain and much suffering in order for us to develop, comrades. But even in our suffering, I see a strength growing. I see the example that George set. We know that all of us will die someday, but we know that there are two kinds of death. The reactionary death and the revolutionary death. One death is significant and the other is not. George certainly died in a significant way, and his death will be very heavy, while the death of the ones that fell that day in San Quentin will be lighter than a feather. Even those who support them now will not support them in the future, because we're determined to change their minds. We'll change their minds, or else in the people's name, we'll have to wipe them out thoroughly, wholly, absolutely, and completely. All power to the people. All power to the people. All words are inadequate to express the pain one feels over a fallen comrade. But in a poem, brothers and sisters, that we read last week, and we're going to read here today, and we're going to read until we finish, Blood of My Eye, by Huey P. Newton's brother, Melvin, came closer than any to voicing our feelings about the loss of George Jackson. We called him the general. The sky is blue. Today is clear and sunny. The house that George once lived in headed for the grave. While the panther spoke of the spirit, I saw a man move cat-like across the rooftops, glide along the horizons, casting no shadow, only chains into the sea, using his callous hands and broken feet to smash and kick down barriers. The angel say his name is George Lester Jackson, El General. All power to the people, brothers and sisters. I'll see you, comrades, next week. At this time, it was wonderful listening to you chime in, and we'll do it again next week. All power to the people.
All power.
All power.
All power to the people.